homeschooling children, there is an invitation from the brethren at Southern Cross Baptist Church to join on Monday the 6th at their school. There is a presentation by the Creation Ministries on that morning from 9 a.m. They have a presentation for the juniors, the primaries, and then at around 10 a.m. for the seniors there. So that is Monday the 6th, if you'd like to take advantage of that. But that is for anybody who would like to be there. That also will be available. Welcome to each one. We are glad that you can join us. Welcome to those also who join us online. We trust the Lord will bless you through whatever your challenge this morning and as you gather with us online. Thank you to those who play the music for us. We do enjoy some Christ-honoring music. That is always a blessing. Let's turn our Bibles to Hebrews and chapter 4 this morning. Were you conscious that we were looking at Hebrews 4 this morning, Phil? Were you conscious of Hebrews 4 this morning? Yeah, just that we're in Hebrews. Well, he read a passage this morning from Matthew where Jesus invites us to come to him. And he wants to give us rest. All you who labor and are heavy laden, I will give you rest. That's a wonderful promise, isn't it? And that is totally in fitting with our message this morning. The song, Jesus, I am resting, resting, is what our text is all about this morning. So if you found Hebrews chapter 4, Hebrews 4, would you stand together with me as we read through the chapter this morning, please? Hebrews 4 and verse number 1. Let us therefore fear, lest a promise being left us of entering into his rest, any of you should seem to come short of it. For unto us was the gospel preached, as well as unto them. But the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. For we which believe do enter into rest, as he said, as I have sworn in my wrath, if they shall enter into my rest, although the works were finished from the foundation of the world. For he spoke in a certain place of the seventh day on this wise, and God did rest the seventh day from all his works. And in this place again, if they shall enter into my rest. Seeing therefore it remaineth that some must enter therein, and they to whom it was first preached entered not in because of unbelief. Again, he limiteth a certain day, saying in David, today after so long a time, as it is said, today if you will hear his voice, harden not your hearts. For if Jesus had given them rest, then would he not afterward have spoken of another day? There remaineth therefore a rest to the people of God. For he that is entered into his rest, he also hath ceased from his own works, as God did from his. Let us labor, therefore, to enter into that rest, lest any man fall after the same example of unbelief. For the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Neither is there any creature that is not manifest in his sight, but all things are naked and opened unto him, unto the eyes of him with whom we have to do. Seeing then we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. For we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Well, those last few verses we're not going to be looking at this week. We're going to look from verses 1 through 13, And the subject is that of rest. The challenge is, are you resting? Now, with that thought, we don't want anybody nodding, okay? But we want to confirm that we are resting. Let's pray. Our Father, we are thankful for your word, and we ask that you'd minister to our hearts through it, challenge us as we consider what the Spirit says. We do thank you for your word. Your word is truth. We thank you for the ministry of your Holy Spirit, and we ask that you'd convict. Lord, we pray that Christ might be glorified this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. So the subject is rest. There's a couple of illustrations that we find through here, and we'll just throw it all out on the table so we can think through what we're talking about here. God gives a couple of illustrations of rest. One of them is, well, it's the chief and primary illustration in the Bible of rest. It's the Sabbath day. God gave the Sabbath. The Bible shows us in Genesis that God labored for 6 days, and on the seventh day, God rested. When God then spoke to Israel, he said, I'm going to make a covenant with you, Israel, and I'm going to give you a covenant testimony, and it's the Sabbath day. And just as I labored for seven days and then rested, Israel must rest on the seventh day. In fact, those who broke the Sabbath day commandment were to be put to death. This was serious business. There were a great many rules and regulations on the Sabbath. And then, of course, the Israelites in later times made all their extra rules and regulations, which God had not intended. But they took this very seriously, the emphasis on rest. And God refers to that, how that God had labored and then he rested. And so we also ought to learn the principle of rest. It's a good principle, just as a principle of life. You do more in your active time if you take time to rest. You will accomplish more. Your body is built to need that. God wants that recharge for you. He wants us to learn to rest. There's another illustration given in this passage, and it's the illustration of Israel entering into the promised land. The promised land was the land of rest. For 400 years, they had labored as slaves in Egypt. And God brought them out that he might bring them in to a place of rest. Of course, we remember that having traveled in the wilderness, they established the principles of worship. And then God led them right down to Canaan, where they would enter into his rest. And they said, oh no, that's too scary. We will not go in. We will not enter in. Let's make us a leader and head back to Egypt. Surely there's something better than this. We remember the leeks and the onions and the garlics that we had back there. We want the goodies from Egypt. They were afraid to enter into God's rest. And he challenges us with that same challenge. Beware lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief. You see, unbelief is that which hinders us from entering into God's rest. I'll give you a little key to this passage. There is down here something which would confuse some. Verse number 8, it says, if Jesus had given them rest, then would he not afterward have spoken of another day? The name Jesus there is the New Testament rendition of the Hebrew for Joshua. Of course, Joshua led Israel into Canaan. And so he's just been talking about them refusing to go in. And then he said, Joshua never gave them rest in its fulfillment. Even when they finally entered in, that was just a picture. Just like the Sabbath day was just a picture. It was to help us to understand the concept of entering into God's rest. God wants us to learn what it means to rest. not physically, much more than that. They entered Canaan. It was the place of God's wonderful blessing. We call it the what? The what land? The promised land. It was the land of God's promise. And God has promised us rest. Not through Joshua. If Joshua had have given them a sufficient rest, we wouldn't need a greater rest. That's what he's saying here. So don't be confused by the name Jesus there. He's speaking about Joshua, but we can sort of go, hang on a minute, what am I talking about then? How does, if Jesus can't give me rest, where is there rest? No, he's saying Joshua never gave us rest. Christ can give us rest. That's the whole point that he makes in the passage. But I want you to draw out with me just another distinction that we want to find here. It's something that we've sort of we've seen glimpses of in the earlier chapters of Hebrew. It's going to be emphasized throughout the book, and we need to understand this. Paul is addressing Hebrews, Jews, people of the Jewish faith. Some of them had come to understand that Christ was salvation, that he was the fulfillment of all these things, the fulfillment of the law, the fulfillment of the prophets, the fulfillment of all the priesthood, the fulfillment of all the offerings and the sacrifices. It was all about Christ. They had everything in Christ. But some of them hadn't. Maybe they were there with the other Jews. So there were some people who had trusted Christ and some people who maybe believed but didn't really believe. Do you understand what I'm saying? Believed but didn't really believe. A head belief, we know about Jesus. We understand some of that concept, but they hadn't actually trusted him. Do you know there are a lot of people in the world today who believe but they haven't really believed? They believe about Jesus. They maybe acknowledge him. They may be religious. They may be religious zealots, but not saved. Paul was one of them. He was zealous for his religion and for his God, his belief in God, and yet he'd never believed on the Lord Jesus Christ and been saved. I want you to turn to verse number 2 there. Look at verse number 2, and I want you to see the distinction that he makes. For unto us was the gospel preached as well as unto them. I want you to notice two words there. The word us and the word them. The word us and the word them. We're going to see these come up again throughout the book. Us and them. Two different groups. You know who he's talking about? He's talking about the saved and the lost. People who know the truth. Among those, there are those who have received it and are saved, and there are others who know about it, but they are lost. They may be sitting side by side in a church someplace. They may be sitting under the sound of the truth of the Word of God, and they all say, I believe. And yet on Judgment Day, God reckons that there is a distinction there, that some are saved and some are lost. That some have received the Lord Jesus and others only acknowledged him. So the challenge right from the outset in this passage, he says in verse number 1, let us therefore fear lest some of us, lest a promise being left us of entering into his rest, any of you should seem to come short of it. God wants us to have his rest, that is eternal salvation. And yet some people, even though they know about it, are going to miss out on it. What made the distinction between us and them? Verse 2 tells us. Unto us was the gospel preached as well as unto them. They both got the same gospel. But the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. See, by grace are you saved through faith. And it's only the one that trusts the Lord Jesus for salvation. He is the beneficiary of God's rest. That's what it means to be saved. We're looking at greater things this morning. I want to look first at a greater rest. We're going to look at a greater choice We're going to look at a greater earnestness, and we're going to see a greater scrutiny. And I want you to follow along with me as we look at these things. Verse number one says that there was a promise given. Well, God gave Israel a promise of rest. And yet, he says, watch out, because some people could just miss out on the promises of God. That would be a sad thing, wouldn't it? God makes a promise, and yet it doesn't seem to eventuate. Some of you would remember times when Dad says, on Saturday we're going to go down to the park, or on Saturday we're going to go fishing, or on Saturday we're going to fill in the blanks, whatever it might be. And then Saturday came and went, and you never went to the park, went fishing, or did whatever. And you say, hang on a minute, there was a promise that never came to fruition. Now, there may have been good, let's give Dad the benefit of the doubt, maybe it rained. Maybe he got called into to work or whatever it might have been, some reason that didn't happen. Wouldn't it be a sad thing if God gave us a promise and it never eventuated? But we know God is bigger than that. God is not unfaithful to his promises. But the warning here is that some may miss out on that promise being realized in their lives. Then over to verse number 8. If Jesus, Joshua, had given them rest, then would he not afterward have spoken of another day? I want you to just consider what he's talking about, that another day, another day. What he's saying is, God made a promise to Israel through Joshua that there would be rest. And God has made a promise to all today that there is rest, another rest, a greater rest, a greater promise. The promised land was a pretty good promise, a land flowing with milk and honey, a land of blessing. God said, I will bless Abraham and the children of Abraham. God intended that for his people, his chosen people. And God says to all who will come unto God through Christ, he will bless them with rest. There remains another day, a day of rest, the entering into the actual rest of God. This is God's intention for us. This is a greater promise than they of Israel had. It's a greater promise than Joshua enjoyed, because we have a greater than Joshua here today. We have the Lord Jesus, and he offers us something stronger, something more certain, a greater promise. Joshua gave them rest, but not lasting rest. In fact, it was only as you turn over to the next book in your Bible, the book of Judges, that Israel was under threat in their own land, maybe carried off in different parts, restored, and God gave judges, and then the cycle went over and over and over for the next 400 years. And then the period of the kings, division and struggle, as many of them rejected God as their basis. And then after that, God took them, the land of Israel, off with the Chaldeans, and the land of Judah off to Babylon, and there they were judged of God, removed from their rest. By the time that Jesus came along, they had been restored to their land. But they never ruled their land. Rome was over them. They were a broken people, subjugated, ruled over. They weren't enjoying rest. But God gave a greater promise. The promise of absolute rest. A promise which goes beyond the externals of the land in which we live, that reaches the depths of our heart. The promise of eternal salvation, forgiveness of sins, the clearing of guilt, the dealing with the heart issues of life. God promised another day. Jesus said in Matthew 11, 28 and 29, as was referred to earlier, "Come unto me, all ye that labour and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your souls." That's what Jesus offers us. It is a great promise. Are you resting? "Jesus, I am resting in the joy of what thou art." That's the only place you'll find real rest. The world is going to mess us up and give us all kinds of struggles. People fail us, and we're going to end up troubled. Jesus offers us rest, a greater promise. But Jeremiah is a challenge to the people of Israel. In chapter 6 and verse 16, he tells us this: "Thus saith the Lord, stand ye in the ways and see, and ask for the old paths, where is the good way, and walk therein, and you shall find rest unto your souls." But sadly, he goes on and says, "But they said, we will not walk therein." God had offered Israel rest and they rejected it. They did not want rest. It would be a horrible thing, wouldn't it, if God promised the potential for genuine soul rest, not soul sleep, but for us to rest in God's salvation, and we missed it. What a terrible thing that would be. A greater promise. Somebody said you can't break God's promises by leaning on them. That's a great thing. But he goes on and emphasizes there needs to be a greater choice. Verse 9. "There remaineth therefore a rest unto the people of God." A rest which surpasses the rest of the Sabbath day. A rest which surpasses the rest of Canaan and the promised land. Verse 10, "For he that is entered into his rest, he also hath ceased from his own works as God did from his." Just like God labored and then he rested, God tells us that those who are saved have ceased from their own works. That's what it means to rest. Here we have the greater choice. There is a choice that recognizes I cannot bring rest to my own soul. I cannot by my labors earn heaven. I cannot by my goodness earn God's forgiveness. I cannot clear the debt that I owe by my sin. I need a Savior. The Bible speaks of God giving his forgiveness to he that cometh to God by him. Those who come in faith in the Lord Jesus Christ must rest from their own works. We're reminded of simple verses like Ephesians chapter 2, where it says, "By grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves." It is a gift from God. "Not of works, lest any man should boast." Now, I remind you that the religions of the world emphasize that you can believe in Jesus, but you must earn heaven by what you do. You must be good enough. You must labor and work to earn heaven. And God here is telling us that never will do. He that is trying to earn his salvation is trusting in himself. He cannot rest. There is no rest in that. He will never enter the rest of God until he learns to cease from his own works. It's not about how good I am. I'm not good enough. It's not about how often I go to church. I don't go enough. I cannot do sufficient to pay for my sin. The beginning of faith is the end of works for salvation. There is no more works for salvation. There is not works to earn it in the beginning. There is not works to keep it as we go on. You think I'm good enough? You're good enough? We're not. We're not. We cannot be. If there is a small portion of your faith that lingers in, well, I'm a good person, you're lost. And the point that Paul makes here is, so many of you Jews, he says, having a promise of God's rest, are going to fall short of it. You're going to miss out on it. Because you will not cease from your own works. What a sad thing to have the promise of God in one hand and yet not to be able to enjoy it because we're holding on to our own goodness and our own works in the other hand. And if that's the reality of where we stand, we will miss out on the rest of God. It comes down to a simple choice. Stop. And in simple faith, rest. What Jesus did when he died on the cross was absolutely sufficient. The Bible tells us that God was satisfied when he saw the work of Christ. It dealt sufficiently with our sin. It paid the penalty fully. Nothing more can be done. Nothing more can be added. So, the day of resurrection became a day of victory. The law was completed. The Old Testament was fulfilled. All of those pictures found their fulfillment in Christ. The Sabbath was fulfilled. Real rest was made a possibility. And so we find that the New Testament church, when they gathered, never celebrated the Sabbath. They never gathered on the Sabbath day to find their rest physically. They gathered on the first day of the week because they remembered that Christ died for our sins, was buried, and that he was raised again the third day. And in him we have rest and we have ceased from our own works, and they enjoyed the fullness of rest. A man was laboring, an elderly man. He had a heavy load and he was walking down the road. This was in the Philippines. And as he walked down the road, a man on a cart with a caribou in front drove alongside of him. And he took pity on the guy and said, looks like it's a heavy load. Why don't you climb on the back and we'll get you where you're going. So the elderly gentleman climbed on the back. Well, they drove on for a little while, and the guy who was driving the caribou train there, he turned around and had a look, and he found that the old guy was still fatigued under his load. He rejected the reality of rest. He was half in, but he wasn't enjoying the benefits. There are those people, you know, who know about Jesus, who believe in Jesus, but have not trusted him entirely for salvation. There's no rest there. They've missed the rest. And so really, in the book of Hebrews, what we see is a constant plea from Paul to his own people to say, it's not enough just to know the facts. It's not enough to taste. You need to embrace Christ fully and be saved. A greater promise, rest, is offered to those who will come to him. A greater choice, we need to choose to enter into that rest. A greater earnestness, Hebrews 4 and verse number 11. Earnestness never brings us salvation. But let's see what he says here in verse 11. Let us labor, therefore. That's a funny concept, isn't it? He says, I want you to rest, so work. But oh, hang on, this is hurting my head. Let us labor, therefore, to enter into that rest, lest any man fall after the same example of unbelief. a minute. He says, be diligent. That's what the word labor speaks of there. Give yourself to it. Be absolutely committed. Don't be half in. Halfway faith is not faith at all. A faith that says it believes and yet hangs on to something else, that's not faith. I believe in Jesus, but I'm hanging on to my church. I believe in Jesus, but I have to be a good person. No. Halfway faith didn't save anybody. He said, I want you to give all seriousness to this. One Savior, one salvation. There is one way that we can be forgiven. Christ is everything, or Christ is nothing. Take it or leave it. Be in or be out. Don't try and straddle the fence. You're just not going to get there like that. That just hurts. Get in. Trust Christ only. Only. None of you. All of him. A new cake came on the market. Well, we were just talking the other day about Mother's Day and the possibility of a cake bake, which we annually do on Mother's Day. Some of the guys cook up a cake. And one of the gracious allowances is we are allowed to use, you're not allowed to just buy a cake and bring it, that doesn't work. But you are allowed to use a cake mix. That works. You've got to do your own bit to it. Well, there was a company that produced a cake mix, and they said all you have to do is add water and bake. They found that sales were really poor. And they decided that what was going on in the minds of people is it's actually too simple. They developed their marketing ploy just a little bit and they remarketed the same product. And it said, add an egg and water and bake. And they found that it started selling because people felt like they had to do something. And it was just too simple. You know, the devil's been remarketing God's salvation all these years. God said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. And the devil says, that's too easy. Believe and add a bit of works. Believe and you maintain it for the rest of your life. Believe and make sure you're in church, otherwise it's just not going to, you know, it doesn't count. Believe and make sure you don't do any of the biggies. He remarketed God's salvation and people bought it. All over the world people buy it. It's an add your own efforts to salvation. And Hebrews is telling us they can know all about the rest that God promises and fall short and miss out. I hope that's not you today. That you know it, but you miss it. That you don't really know of the rest that God offers. It's a danger for every child born in a Christian home. Surrounded by Christianity, we grow up knowing all the truths of the gospel, and yet, was there ever a day when we personally embraced Christ as sufficient and enough and all? Has to be, or else as close as you might come, you've missed the point. Sitting under the gospel ministry all our lives, but having missed it, there needs to be a conscious and a deliberate entering into the rest of Christ. This is not something that happens by accident, and it's not something that happens progressively. Now, I want to just make a comparison. When your child is naughty, there's unrest takes place. A home develops a whole spirit of unrest. That's why God challenged parents to discipline your child. You know the concept, spare the rod, spoil the child? That's Bible. Why? Because when sin is dealt with, when the child has a good spanking and he is brought to repentance, he can rest. There's nothing outstanding now. Sin is dealt with. Like when we're out at the shops and maybe one of the kids would play up and you just whisper in the ear, you just wait till we get home. And they get home and you know what? There is no rest. The Bible tells us the wicked are like the troubled sea, whose waters cast up mire and dirt. There is no rest, saith my God, to the wicked. You know what? Sin troubles us. At times I forgot to discipline our children when I'd warned them of what was coming. And we remember times as they would come and say, Dad, you forgot to discipline me. Why did they do that? You know what they wanted? They wanted rest. When sin is dealt with, there's peace, peace of heart. Guilt is removed. I'm free again. We live in a world troubled by guilt. But Christ will remove the guilt when he brings complete forgiveness to the one who comes to God by him. By conscious and deliberate submission to God, I come not as a good person deserving heaven, for then I would be rejecting the grace of God. I come as a sinner deserving judgment and fall at the mercy of God. I believe that Jesus died for me. He dealt with my sin, was buried and raised again. In simple faith, I accept what he's done for me. And by submission to God, a man is saved. And he enters the rest of God. This is a conscious and deliberate submission to the authority of God on our lives. A greater earnestness. We need to be serious about this thing. Are you saved? But then we get to further into the passage here, verse number 12, a verse that many of us are familiar with. A great memory verse. The word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joints and the marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. We get to the point here of a greater scrutiny. I want you to understand what he's saying. It's not just a sword for battle, for fighting with as we go to approach lost people. It's a sword that gets into me. You know, the Bible refers to itself as the mirror of the word. And so in James, a glass, or 1 Corinthians, we see the looking glass or the mirrors of the ladies there. We look in the mirror and we see ourselves. And we look into the Word of God and it is a great discerner of our hearts. The Word of God is certainly a book of comfort, but it's also a book of great distress. And if you look into the Word of God and all you're looking for is comfort, you probably won't find it. For God must distress our soul, first of all, if we would truly enter into the rest and find the comfort of soul. You see, it tells us here that he is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. So the lost man who, yes, he's heard of this Jesus and he believes in Jesus and maybe even knew him to be true. And maybe he's observed others who've loved and known Christ and how God has done a work in their lives and maybe changed their lives. Maybe he steps into church and comes to church with them, and maybe he's around the people of God. He may even get involved in church. You know, he may even be a Sunday school teacher. He may be involved in doing some things. There have been preachers who have been in these shoes before. They've tasted and seen all the truths of the gospel, but never been saved. Maybe in their heads somewhere was the idea that I need to serve God more to be more acceptable to God, or I need to do better to be more acceptable to God, or I need to live better, or I need to cease from doing certain things. And all of these things were an endeavor to be what he observed some other Christian to be. And he saw a godly Christian over there enjoying God's rest, and he said, I'm going to join with him, and I'm going to be like him, and I'm going to dress like him, and I'm going to get a haircut like him, and I'm going to look like him, and I'm going to sing the songs like him, and I'm going to be like him. And you know what? He is not like him. He's a lost man. And God gets in and he discerns the intents of the heart. Why did you do those things? Well, I was trying to be right. Missed the point. God's word reveals to us that you're not made righteous by what you do. Righteousness is bestowed upon all those who trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. And you don't maintain righteousness by what you do. Fellowship is established in Christ and maintained as we walk with God. God's word gets in. Have you ever been made uncomfortable by the word of God? Where God puts his finger on something and you go, yeah, that's me. That's good. That's what his word is about. I spoke once of a guy that knifed me in the back of my neck. He was a doctor. He was helping me. He cut out some things that shouldn't have been there and enabled me to get better. It sounds like a horrible thing, but he was actually doing me a favor. And God, by his word, gets in and deals with the issues of the heart, right down to what I'm thinking. I don't know what you're thinking, but God does. He knows every thought. He knows every intention. He knows why you're in church. He knows if you're hoping to aspire to salvation by what you can do. And he knows and puts it so plain before us in his words. You're going to miss out. Close, but not close enough. As close as church, but never enjoying the rest of God. Young people, make your own choice. Receive Christ personally. Walk with God individually. Nobody can do that for you. Old people, trust Christ alone. Nothing else. Leaving all and trusting Christ. Or as close as you might think you got, you'll have missed the boat. Let us therefore fear, lest the promise being left us of entering into his rest, any of you should seem to come short of it. What a tragedy. To almost touch the very promises of God and yet to miss them. And miss out on eternal blessedness. If you're not saved today, if you're not sure that you're saved today, why don't you make today the day that you choose to trust Christ only and receive him as sufficient to save and bless you. Let's pray. Our Father, we are thankful for a Savior who is sufficient. His work dealt with sin in its entirety. We thank you, each one who knows you, for the rest of God, and that in Christ we can enter into your rest. We thank you that there remains a rest unto the people of God who will receive it. And Lord, we pray for any who may not know with certainty that their sin is forgiven, who may not have entered into your rest. And like Israel, though they tasted the fruits of Canaan, yet they refused to enter in because of unbelief. Lord, stir the hearts of each one who may be lost. By your word, cut into them to the very deepest parts of their hearts to reveal sin and a need for salvation. And we'll thank you and glorify your name.